So our very special guest with us today, Mr. Sanjay Manwani. He has been managing and working closely with open source database technologies for the past 12 years and is currently managing the MySQL India team, which is involved in all aspects of SQL development. Not only that, but he's also a speaker at multiple events. So without further ado, let's welcome Mr. Sanjay Manwani. Mr. Sanjay, over to you. Hi, Mr. Sanjay. I think your mic is muted. Mr. Sanjay, your mic is still muted.
I'm so sorry. Okay, let me start. So I'd like to thank you for this opportunity for first session. Thank you for the introduction. Quickly, let me get started. Not much time and too many slides. So this is kind of our, it's about 6 or 7 since we've kind of started our database service on the Oracle Cloud Infrastructure. There are a lot of clouds that have, MySQL, but, there is this service that we have begun now, and this is a native service. So let me just get started. This is a safe harbor statement. In the previous presentation, I was looking that people were asking, what is this for? This basically is that, whatever I'm presenting is just for information purpose. Though if you make any decision based on this presentation, based on any date, then basically you can't say, oh, Sanjay said this and therefore we did it. And that's what it prevents us from getting sued, basically. So that's it. Quick agenda, I'll talk about the market trends. I'll talk about MySQL and its customers. Kind of introduction very quick. I will talk about the database service and I will talk about HeatWave, which is kind of the latest thing that we have implemented. And this is specially required for analytics workloads. This is a very, very new thing, extremely hot, and it's available only on the MySQL database service on Oracle Cloud. So this is very, very specific to that. And I will also talk about a little bit about, what our customers are saying, we have and we are doing, and how much do they like our services. Okay. So, standard things, data is growing exponentially. I think it's really, really growing much. And, earlier the people used to have text pages, then they started having photographs. Now there are videos. Everybody wants to search everything, access everything. So we can imagine what data is going to be like with AI, and I don't know, we'll have maybe holographic images soon on the web. You can see people in 3D, and everything is going to be on the web. Imagine how data is going to be, right? And it is moving to the cloud. Like, a lot of people had their own data centers where they were saving everything, or they wanted to have it on their laptops. So we see the trend that, as far as consumers are concerned, people are not keeping their data at home. They're too scared because hard disk crash and things like that. There is a lot of data that is increasing and going into the public cloud. And that is the trend is only expected to grow, right? In fact, even now, today, you can't imagine that, you'll keep your pictures in a public cloud, right? But everybody does that backup, and you take a picture and it goes into your Google Photos or something like that. So 49% of world's data is going to reside in public clouds. That's, some of the predictions which are being made by IDC. And as far as even databases are concerned, right, a lot of the databases people are going to start using on the cloud. As people start trusting data on the cloud, they're going to say, okay, yes, I'm good. I have my data center. I have my cloud. I have the trust on the cloud that the cloud is going to keep my data safe, because that's the biggest thing, right? Why do banks want to have, or governments want to have, that data in-house? Is because they have a worry that people are going to steal that data. But this trust is so slowly going to increase. There is, I think currently it's a time of hybrid databases where people have some data inside the data center, some data on the cloud, or exclusively, one or the other way, depending on, how much they worry or how much trust they have on the cloud. But this trend is going to accelerate. It is going to, move more and more of the databases is going to be on the cloud. So people are going to start using databases on the cloud. And as I said, I think the biggest worry that people have is, okay, is it secure? Is my data secure, right? There are thousands of people, there are insiders, former employees, nation state criminals, curiosity seekers. Everybody wants to look at your data. Everybody wants to basically, you know, take away your data for some, in some way or the other. So whether it's personal data, financial data, you have to basically keep it safe and secure, right? And as I said, security, if you look at, you know, CXO survey, all right, what is it that they're worried about? Why, you know, why do they want to kind of move to the cloud? What people have realized is that these large cloud companies, they have, you know, they have a better capability of managing security than anything else. So they want to move to, you know, to the cloud, right? And there is a lot more security there. Obviously, there is cost, scalability, ease of management and speed. But I think security is one of the big factors that people are trusting clouds now. And, you know, people still are, I mean, open source is more valuable and important today than it was a long time back. Because, you know, as far as open source is concerned, you can be sure that whether the company that manages, you know, particular open source data is there or not, at least you have, you know, the code of that open source. And there will be other people if the, you know, if there is value in the code itself, it doesn't, it's not important what if the company that has the code or has created the code, is it, you know, doing well or not doing well, that is not important. But there will be multiple people that can support, you know, this open source thing. So the value of enterprise open source is also accelerating. It allows for better collaboration. It allows for, you know, as I said, survivability. It allows for migration between clouds. There are these many things that, you know, open source brings you. And that's the reason that, you know, conferences like FOSS Asia, they are very, very important, right? Because then we talk about, you know, how important open source is. So there is going to be cloud, there is going to be open source, and the databases are moving to this, you know, kind of open source databases are going to move to the cloud. That's kind of the, you know, the thing. And right now what is happening is that a lot of innovation work that is happening, the new things that are happening, it is happening on, you know, open source platforms. So if I want to do something new, exciting, interesting, it is sometimes, many times it started by university students, and they, you know, the cheapest and the easiest way to manage is just, you know, using open source. So there are companies that want to therefore also leverage it, and there are students that want to leverage it, and together I think there is a huge amount of open source innovation that is happening, right? And I don't need to say this, open source databases are mainstream, you know. People were, this is probably a slide from when people were a little worried about open source databases, but you know, Gartner is saying it today that, you know, open source databases are kind of mainstream. Let's just talk about MySQL a little bit. So if you look at, you know, DB Engines, this is a company that rates databases, and it talks about how popular databases are, and there are marks that are given. And I'm sure, you know, if you have any idea about databases, you would have looked at the DB Engines rating. And this is from kind of March 2021 that we've talked about. And if you look at it, MySQL is number two. Oracle is not an open source database. It's a proprietary database. MySQL is the number one open source database out there. And it is, you know, if you look at the numbers given to it, we are, you know, quite far away from, if you look at the top five or six, they are, you know, at 400. And then suddenly, you know, when you get to IBM, it drops to 156. So, you know, kind of 1/10 of the usage of these kind of databases. As you go below, you know, you see a lot of also churn there, right? Redis is coming up, Elasticsearch is going down, SQLite is coming up, Microsoft Access is going down and up. So these are things that keep moving around. What kind of is constant is kind of the top four or five that are quite stable, and they keep on growing. So what you need to see, you know, just basically the focus is MySQL is number one, and we are number one by far. And it is popular. People want to use MySQL, you know, they are either using it, or they say, okay, they are planning to use it, because there's a lot of innovation, there's a lot of change that, you know, is happening. And these are kind of surveys from Stack Overflow, JetBrains, both of them on the same thing. And, you know, whether it is social, e-commerce, SaaS, finance, fintech, you know, people can say, okay, but we are this kind of company, that kind of company. Doesn't matter what kind of company you are. You know, there are use cases. You know, Facebook, Twitter have huge use cases. New e-commerce companies have kind of the newest thinking that has been implemented using MySQL. So this is kind of, you know, this thing that I want to talk about. Generics, let's get to specifics. What is this whole MySQL database service? As I said, you know, if you're managing your own MySQL, you're always worried. Do I have the latest security fix? You have to have a DBA team in place that gets the latest fixes. You need to make sure that security regulatory compliances are there. You know, there's a new patch that has come, security patch. There's a new security library I have to implement it. You know, I have to make sure that, you know, my cloud database and my on-premise database are in sync. Let us suppose I have a, my replicas, which are there on different clouds, or the other way around. I have a master in one and I have replicas somewhere else. How do I replicate, right, between? Then if there are multiple technologies, let us suppose, you know, I'm interested in Oracle. 70% of Oracle people use MySQL. How do I integrate with that? How do I get technical support? So then you need to work with a cloud that understands Oracle, which understands MySQL, and preferably that has developed MySQL. I know there are a lot of implementations of MySQL that are there, which have been done by Google, Microsoft, all these kind of companies. But what they're doing is they're taking what we have created, you know, making some changes to it, adding some things to it, deleting some things to it, making sure that it works on the cloud, and then giving you that service, right? While as it's not true, or, you know, this is our strength, that it's the team that has built the MySQL server is now bringing you this, service available to you. And it is based on the Enterprise Edition. This is the first time I'm talking about Enterprise Edition on FOSS Asia, because now, as far as cloud is concerned, it brings everything together. So whether it is, you know, the latest audit, whether it is the latest security features, whether it is, you know, all kinds of security key infrastructure that we integrate with, everything is today available to you because the Enterprise Edition is available to you. Again, the database service is easy because it's fully managed by us, right? So we will have the screens, and if there is anything that goes wrong, we will take care of it. The moment you click, it is automatically provisioned and you get the latest version, right? It is 100% secure. We are guaranteeing it. There is data protection, there is advanced security, and the security updates are something that's our problem. Because it's implemented in our cloud, we take care of all that, right? And it is, as I said, built on Enterprise Edition, and it is on-premise compatible. So it's the same code that works both, and it's built on the second generation of Oracle infrastructure. I will talk about that a little bit. So what is it? So it's not only the database that we are taking care of, the OS is something that we are taking care of, the server we are taking care of, storage, data center. You don't have to worry about, you know, my networking is going to go down, my whatever, you know, air conditioners are going to go down. Everything is taken care by us. So what is this second generation cloud? The second generation cloud, so we tried, Oracle tried a cloud first, and then it realized, okay, there are certain changes that are required. We need to focus on security, you know, way better performance. It has to be cheaper, and has to be a complete, you know, open ecosystem that we need to create. So this is a second generation cloud that has been created. And, you know, we are not talking about it, but if you read anywhere, all the analysts are saying it is the most secure cloud that is out there. And it's not that it's just the expensive cloud. It is also the cheapest cloud. So if you look at just, you know, how much does it cost you for 100 OCPUs and 1 terabyte of storage for MySQL, it be the cheapest out there. I know a lot of people are, you know, these are numbers that you need to look about, but we are way, way cheaper. And we are not only cheaper as far as the MySQL service is concerned, we are cheaper as far as storage is concerned, the backup is concerned. You know, when you bring in data, when you take out data, all these things are way, way cheaper on the, on the Oracle Cloud. And therefore, basically your TCO comes really down. Let's talk about, you know, HeatWave a little bit, because that's our latest, newest, and most interesting thing. Okay. So typically, if you wanted to do analytics, right, what you would do is you will have your data in something like a MySQL or a front-end database, then you'll clean it up, because there'll be customer specific data, there will be some credit card numbers, health information. You'll clean it all up, you'll put it into an OLAP database, and from that OLAP database, then you're going to basically create your data cubes, and then using those data cubes, you're going to take out your whatever information that you wanted with these huge reports and things like that. And a part of that information is going to go back into your database, because there is a single view that people want to have with their data. So there's a whole cycle, and some of these cycles will take days, some of these cycles will take months. Definitely you can't do analysis in a very short time. It takes a long time. So for example, when companies want to bring out their own reports, right? So it takes a long time for bringing out their quarterly reports. With HeatWave, right, which is our kind of OLAP accelerator or OLAP extension, if you can say, it is the same database that you're working on. So now there's a single MySQL database. You can do OLTP on it, and you can do analytics on it, because as far as HeatWave is concerned, it's like another engine, and it is an in-memory engine built in, right? And the moment you make any changes, and I have a nice diagram for it. I think let's go back to the diagram. I will basically go back to the diagram. So your all the data, everything that is working, works exactly the same way. And as far as your OLAP queries are concerned, suddenly, as far as the user is concerned, it is suddenly very, very fast. It becomes really like 400 times faster, right? And if you look at the scaling, earlier, you were scaling to maybe 100 cores. Now suddenly you are scaling to thousands of cores. So you have 1,000 parallel threads which are working. This is an absolutely new technology. So basically, Oracle Labs had come out with this. They had their own specialized hardware on how do you parallelize, OLAPs and things like that. And they built in that technology, and they said, okay, who do we integrate it with? And they came to MySQL, and MySQL said, yes, we would love, because again, it's a very, very complementary thing. We are very, very good with OLTP, but we are not good with OLAP. So why don't you bring this engine in? And they integrated this engine, just to show you how this works. Yes, so basically you do an insert, it goes to our optimizer, and from our optimizer, it knows that, okay, this table particularly is a table which is required for my OLAP. And obviously everything is in InnoDB, so that's the source of the truth. But the whole thing goes into your in-memory database, which is HeatWave, right? And this is happening immediately. It's not, there is no time gap here that ETL has to happen, cleanup has to happen, nothing has to happen. If you do want to make sure that there are certain cleanups happen, you write the filters out right there. And this information is going to go into your in-memory presentation, HeatWave database there, which is kind of thing. And from that, when you ask for a result, the result comes, and it basically your query is going to get answered the moment. So there is no wait time here, there is no cleaning here, there is nothing that is happening. Everything is happening extremely, extremely fast, and it is happening extremely seamlessly. As far as you are concerned, as far as the user is concerned, they are giving a MySQL query, and suddenly this MySQL query is fast, right? Okay. So it is completely fast, and because it's a part of Oracle infrastructure, anything that is built in. So for example, we have this beautiful reporting tool in which you can create pie charts, you can create all kinds of waves and graphs and all those things. So all those things are available to you automatically, because any tool that is built for analytics, that is going to directly work on top of MySQL and HeatWave, right? And you can have your OLTP applications pumping in the data to MySQL. You can just add the queries of your OLAP, and those queries will get answered. And beautiful reports can be run using our analytics tools. Again, as I said, if you're talking about 400 GB and 64 cores, this is the speed up that we're talking about, right? If MySQL query was taking 1,700 seconds, it comes down to 4.21 seconds. So it's really, really fast. They will basically, our very first. And the queries that we are talking about the TPCH queries, right? So we have looked at the TPCH queries and we said, okay, you know, in general, what is the speed of execution? We are talking 64 cores here, please remember. Right? And obviously, you know, people are going to say, okay, what does this mean if we compare with Amazon Aurora? Because a lot of people are working currently with Amazon Aurora. So how much faster is HeatWave if we compare it to Amazon Aurora? So if you look at it, it is about 30 times faster in certain cases. Okay, from 5 days. And these are, you know, remember, first you have to do is you have to, in any scenario, you have to, like, these are terabytes and terabytes. So 4 terabyte of data, how much time does it take to load in the first place, right? In case of Aurora, a 4 terabyte data might take about 5 days to load, right? Because it's slow, it's cleaning up and everything is going to happen. So our data preparation time is 4 hours, right? How much is the, you know, is the runtime? The runtime is 1,100 times faster. So a query that would take 2.5 hours in Aurora is going to take you 8 seconds in HeatWave, right? And is it, how much cheaper is it? It's way, way cheaper. So it's 3.5 times cheaper. So you are preparing it quicker, you are running it faster, and you're paying less money. So very, very, you know, makes a lot of sense for this, right? And people are going to say, but, you know, why are you comparing with Aurora? Aurora is not for OLAP. It is HeatWave that we use for, it's basically Redshift we use for our OLAP. So why don't we compare with, with Redshift? So fine, let's compare with Redshift. Here, if you have our analytics queries are about 2.7 times faster, and it is 3 times cheaper. So again, you know, from the cost benefit, it just makes sense to run it on HeatWave. And again, remember, it's seamless. It's a single, screen that you're running. Everything is the same. But then people say, okay, you know, why are you comparing with this $110,000 thing? I can get, you know, way cheaper Amazon Redshift. So, you know, how about, you know, why don't you compare with the Redshift's fastest shape? So if it's the fastest shape, we are 5 times faster and we are 37% cheaper. If you look at, okay, it is the cheapest shape of Amazon Redshift, then we are 17 times faster and still we are, you know, 3% cheaper. So, you know, I don't want to, you know, I can keep talking about my service and I can keep saying it's the best service out there. But let's talk about what our customers are talking about, right? What do they think? What is it that they've seen? Right. So we had, we took it to health engineers, Siemens health engineers, and they tried, you know, HeatWave and MySQL, and they say we discovered astonishing performance improvements from hours to seconds. So exactly what I'm talking about. And remember, this is not something that has been built in a day. Our labs team has taken years and years to develop this, right? And this is our, you know, very, very kind of, it's like, you know, those diamonds that are there, very precious, difficult to come by, but when once implemented, you know, these are some things that you can really enjoy, right? And it becomes very, very easy for them because single seamless database, right? They have one database, and from that one database, as far as analytics is concerned, it happens seamlessly. So what is Mercari saying, right? And remember, these are real-time cases. So as far as our test cases are concerned, we might say 400 times faster or 1100 faster, but there will be some averages that will become common. And as far as customers are concerned, they're saying, okay, we are at least seeing 20 times faster analytics, right? And our acceleration is 45,000 faster than on-premise. So if we have a MySQL, which they were maintaining, Mercari was maintaining, and they tried to, you know, compare it with what's happening on HeatWave, it's 45,000 faster, times faster. So not something that I say, again, something that, our customers are saying. What is Square Enix saying is they wanted to have an analytics workload of social game infrastructure, and their focus was their problem as far as ETL is concerned. So when you move your workload from your standard database, which you use for day-to-day OLTP, and then you want to do analytics, like, you know, moving mountains, right? You take one data, you clean it up, and you know, all that cleaning used to take them many, you know, difficult times. So they're saying our analytics engine is 500 faster, and we require zero ETL, right? So ETL that again, you know, what I just told you, this is exactly what you know, our customers are also saying. Again, SCSK Corporation, we are analytics engine is 10 times faster than analytics service, and no need for ETL. So just, you know, repeating things that people are talking about right now. I think if you are wanting to test this out and, you know, kick the tires of it, you get about $300 credit. So what I would say is just go down, search for MySQL HeatWave, search for the, you know, the service of Oracle Cloud, try it out, you know, try your hands, try your fingers on it. This is the latest, newest thing and the fastest thing, and it's really, really state of the art. So if there is state of the art analytics that you want to think about, if there is, you know, state of the art scaling that you want to think about, because this thing scales from you know, one core to I think thousands of cores, and yeah, as far as the scaling is concerned, you know, it is at about 0.8. So you know, it's not 1:1. So if you have one core, it's going to give you one performance. If it's two cores, it's going to give you 2, 3, 4, 2,000. But at least we have 0.8. So you know, 1,000 cores are going to give you 800 or 8,000, 820 times the performance. So it's not really 1,000, but the scaling is kind of quite linear. So try it out. There is there are free coupons that are available. I think for India, there is a $500 coupon that is there. If you're from India, from I think other parts of the country, there's a $300. Try it out for free. And we are in the process of developing it. We are in the process of, you know, implementing it. There are about, I think, 2,000 customers that have tried it. Again, the last 7 months that we've come out with, we're getting extremely good results. You know, we very, very positive things. So I think if you are serious about analytics and cloud, and you're interested in MySQL, this is the thing that you need to get your hands dirty with. Go down there, use your $300, and out is what I would, you know, what I would suggest. Again, DMM Corporation, again, you know, everybody's talking about no changes. And I think that's all that I have. If there are questions, I'll be kind of happy to answer those questions. And I'll stop scaring, you know, my screen share here.
Hello, Mr. Sanjay. Thank you so much for your insightful presentation. Now let's move on to our Q&A segment. So does anyone have any questions for Mr. Sanjay? I think currently there is no questions in the shared notes, but if you would like, you can voice out your questions and or type in the public chat.
Yeah, we have a very shy and quiet guy running this time for Sisha, I think.
Okay, there's a question coming from Gaurav Soni. He is wondering how Oracle can improve the performance compared to other cloud services.
So, one or two things. One is, remember, if you're using any other cloud service from any other provider, it may be a little different, and therefore you might not get latest service. There might be certain things that they might do faster because they have re-implemented certain things for it. So I know that AWS has, you know, some things that are faster and slower. But what I recommend to people always is that when you are talking about any cloud implementation, and especially, again, as I said, in open source, the advantage of open source is that whether I want to use MySQL on cloud number one or cloud number two or cloud number three, I should be able to take it and I should be able to move it around as far as the core MySQL is concerned. So are you getting locked in into a cloud? That is something that you need to worry about. With MySQL, you know that this is the official implementation of MySQL, and this is the official implementation which is available to you on the Oracle Cloud. If somebody, you know, breaks it up, extends it, and this is the same for, you know, any fork, once they change things, then when we come out with a newer version, they have to make their changes source compatible. And it's exactly the same with other cloud vendors. So they will have to create a new extension. They'll have to change something. And then that extension will have to go into their, you know, into their cloud service. If you look at certain providers, they have not even, right now we are on 8.023, right? So there are, even in 8.0, there are 23 versions that have come, right? And whenever we come out with a new version of 8.0, we also come up with, you know, a new version of, you know, our 5.7s, and I think 5.7.80 or some number is going on. So are they able to keep up, right? That is something that you need to understand. And remember, tomorrow, if you want to move from Google Cloud to Oracle Cloud, because Oracle Cloud is cheaper, and tomorrow AWS becomes, you know, cheaper than us, are you able to move your, you know, changes from one cloud to the other? Or if you want to just bring it back on premise, so are you going to be able to, you know, do that? And, you know, let us suppose you say, okay, you know, I don't want to take my services from Oracle. There is another, you know, provider that I want to take it from, which supports core MySQL. Is that cloud provider going to be, or even a company, you know, going to be able to help you on premise, because this is an open source product? That is something that you need to look at. Not only just, okay, you know, performance A versus B. I talk about performance, I'm going to say, you know, this is the best. Another person is going to say, this is the best. Remember, as far as heatwave and analytics is concerned, because it's specific hardware-wise and implementation-wise, currently it's offered only on the cloud. So if you're, you know, comparing analytics, we are way faster than anybody because we understand, you know, the code, we understand the code. So you can't compare heatwave. Nobody has heatwave. Redshift, I already compared. We are way faster than that. But core MySQL, again, I think there are certain things that certain people have done that have made it faster. But if you look at the version that they're supporting a very, very low version. So again, your call. And don't, you know, don't believe me, you know, try your own benchmarks. As you saw, you know, we talked about 400 times the speed, but when we took it to a customer, the customer said it's 20 times faster for me, right? So every implementation, every difference is going to be different, right? Or you know, it depends on your queries that you're using. It depends on what exactly you're trying to work on. Yes, typically I would say we have the latest, we have the fastest, but don't take my word for it. As I said, there are, you know, for 30 days, $300, why don't you, you know, and you know how to run MySQL, just take it, go there, try it out, and I promise you, everything installs in one click. You go there, you say, okay, start my MySQL database, you know, on Oracle Cloud. You say, you know, create it. It's going to get created in some, I think right now it's 20 minutes or something like that. In 20 minutes, it will get created. You know, create your tables, run your queries. There's a beautiful site which the previous presentation talked. Everything is going to work, and it's just try it out. Use your $300 and you tell me how fast it's running.
I see. Yeah. Thank you so much, Mr. Sanjay. He would like to follow up with saying, sure, looking forward to try out the services with free coupons. So, audiences, I think Mr. Ivan has sent three links on Oracle and MySQL. You may want to check those out. In the meantime, does anyone want to voice out their questions? We still have 6 minutes till the end of Q&A. Or Mr. Sanjay, do you have anything else you want to share with the audiences?
So if you look at, there are a lot of conferences that are happening on heatwave specifically. and these are hosted by our senior vice president, who was in charge of the labs team, and his name is Nipun Agarwal. So search for Nipun Agarwal, and I think on 24th there is an open conference that you can attend. And Nipun is actually going to, this is because it was introduction, I just talked about very, very generic stuff about money and benchmarks and things like that. But if you want to look at the implementation, it's a very cool piece of technology, how the nodes are there, how the stuff is there. So if you want to attend any of these conferences, search for our open conference, look for Nipun Agarwal. He's the guy who was heading this whole thing. So look for these conferences and go ahead and, basically try them out, is what I would suggest.
Thank you, Mr. Sanjay. Okay, we're down to last 4 minutes. It's the last chance for y'all to voice out. Does anyone want to unmute yourself and talk to Mr. Sanjay, or we can open up a discussion that we can share more about the open source, about MySQL or Oracle?